welcome back to another episode of Planet Hunters Coffee Chat. I'm your host, Kassie Prolongo, and of course, joining me today is the absolutely wonderful and stellar Nora Eisner. Hey, Nora.
Hi.
I hope that you like the nice pun that I put in there, that you are stellar. I'm
sorry. It's a lovely pun.
I thought so. Got to throw out those jokes. So in our previous episode, we have fun, folks. We like to have fun with this. In our previous episode, we talked a little bit about some early stage resources for citizen scientists and also astronomers. Both would use this thing called MAST, M-A-S-T, which is the Mikulski Archive for Space Telescopes. And today we're continuing on this sort of journey through resources that people can use. But this one is a special one, I feel. This one is the acronym is called ExoFOP, and I don't remember what the entire thing is for. So Nora, hopefully you can tell me the entire thing of what that is. But from what it looks like, this is a collaborative space, and this is something very important that you use as an astronomer in your day-to-day life. So maybe we can dive into this and what it's all about and how you use it and how other people can use it.
Yeah, definitely. I should start off by saying that ExoFOP is absolutely fantastic and I use it all the time. When I say all the time, I'm probably on there, well, I'm definitely on there at least once a day. So it has a lot of really, really useful information on it about what stars are, or what planets are known. It has information about the stars, how bright they are, how big they are, how massive they are. So just lots of really, really useful information that I use on a day-to-day basis. So instead of me just talking about it, I think we should dive in and have a look at it together.
Cool. Okay. So here you can see ExoFOP, and it's great because you've got the acronym spelled out onto the screen, the Exoplanet Follow-Up Observing Program for TESS. We definitely like our acronyms. I know at NASA, we love to use acronyms. It's sort of our modus operandi. So we love to use it. But let's dive into this. What is all of this about? There's a lot of great information on here when I took a look at it. Is this something we need to know right off the bat? Do I need to request an account? Like, I mean, what sort of things should I be aware of going to this website?
Yeah, that's a great question to start with, because when you go onto ExoFOP, you are shown this big blue banner that says request an account. And it's important to know you do not need an account. So anyone can use ExoFOP without an account. So just completely ignore this entire blue banner here at the top. Scroll down a little bit and go to this important box here on the left. So this is where it says target, and this is where you can enter a TIC ID again. So we will just go ahead and do that. We will use my favorite TIC ID, which is 555-25572. So if you remember back to the last video when we looked at MAST, you had to say tick and then the number. But because we're already on a site that is only looking at test data, we don't have to tell it that we're looking at the test input catalog. So we can just put the number straight in there and then press go.
It's good to know.
Oh, it's loading. We will twiddle our thumbs whilst that loads.
Yay, internet, let's go. All right, cool. There we go. All right. Oh, this is really interesting. Okay. Wow. All right. So there's a lot of good stuff going on here. My eye is darting all over the place, but the first thing I've noticed is that box in the left-hand corner, which says TIC ID and then what you just put in. So when we know we're on the right page for this TIC ID.
Yeah, that's a good place to start, to always check that you're on the right page. And as you said, there is so much information on here. And part of being an astronomer is knowing, being given a lot of data and knowing what is useful and what isn't. So hopefully I can break that down just a little bit. So we'll start at the top. We have some what they call basic information. So we have kind of, again, that TIC ID number, and we have some other names for the same star. So a lot of stars are observed by lots of different surveys, and each survey gives it its own kind of name. So sometimes those different names are useful if you're searching for it on a different, in a different archive, for example. We have some other important information. So RA and DEC, this is just where it's located. These are like latitude and longitude on Earth, but these RA and DEC are for space. And we will ignore the rest of that information for now and move down to TESS object of interest. So anything that's flagged by the pipeline that searches for planets, by that main pipeline, And is flagged as a potential candidate, becomes a test object of interest, or a TOI. So you can see this is TOI 813. So this has been found by the pipeline. You then have a number of kind of parameters here. The important one is this master priority parameter. And if you click on this little question mark here, it tells you that number one is high priority. This is a very interesting target. This should be followed up. And five is still interesting, but it's much lower priority. And of course, anything in between, you can scale yourself. Mm-hmm. Cool, let's move down one more. There's a lot of these columns to get through, so we'll see how we go. So next we have community test object of interest. So this is again something that's been flagged by a team or the community. So for example, if we find an interesting candidate on Planet Hunter's test and it hasn't been found by the pipeline, then we can upload it onto ExoFOP as a community TOI. And you can see this one, for example, here, this was uploaded by Agrain. So she's a member of the Planet Hunters test team, and you can see here it's a Planet Hunters test candidate. So the reason why this is both a TOI and a community TOI, or a CTOI as we like to call them, is because we uploaded it as a CTOI and it was later vetted by the automated pipeline team, and they also promoted it to that TOI status.
Okay, so that was going to be my question. So for this community sort of feel, things that are uploaded onto there, then other people basically go through the correct parameters to ensure, is this like a candidate? Is this a viable potential planet? I mean, so is that what basically happens? It goes through like a process after you or whomever uploads the new data up onto this website?
So if you upload a CTOI, you're expected to have already checked all of those things. So we, at Planet Hunters Test, we run a lot of different checks that are, a lot of them are very similar to the checks that the TOI team does. And we run those and then put it up. And then the TOI team might do similar checks again. And if they agree with what we've done, then they promote it to TOI status.
Okay, that's really neat. Excellent. All right, so what is this next one? Planet parameters, okay.
Yes, so we have different columns here. We have confirmed planet. So once it's confirmed, it gets given a letter. And here you have all the parameters for that. But a lot of candidates that you see on ExoFOP won't be confirmed planets, and they'll either be planet candidates, or a lot of the kind of sites on or pages on ExoFOP just don't have any planets or candidates at all. So I should have said at the start of when we went onto ExoFOP is that every single star that is observed by TESS has its own site, regardless of whether there's a planet around it or not. So this is the place where you go if you see a candidate on Planet Hunters TESS or anywhere else, and you want to know, has anyone said anything about this candidate already? Has anyone flagged a planet? Is there already a confirmed one on it? This is the place to find out that information. And what's great about the planet parameters bit here is that if there is anything flagged, then you find a lot of those important parameters on there. So for example, in the last episode, we used the orbital period of yes, the planet to phase fold. And we can find that here under this period column here. So this is one of the places where you can find out what that period is and then use that to phase fold.
Okay, cool. So definitely these are, you know, between MAST and ExoFOP, bookmark these. These are good resources to have. These are resources that astronomers are using as actual tools. And of course, we've got, I noticed on the left-hand side there, you've got the external links, and you even have a link to MAST and other bits on there as well. So these, you can switch back and forth to look at more stuff with the data, which is cool, which is really cool.
Yeah, definitely. It's good to switch between the two and just to use them both side by side.
Yeah.
So the second to last thing I want to mention on this page is the stellar parameters. So regardless of whether there is a planet or not, you might want to just find out more about what that star that you're looking at, just want to find out more about it. So here you can find out things like the temperature of the star, which is the TF, so effective temperature. You can find out things like the radius, how big is the star? We have the mass, we have the density, we have lots of really important information right in front of us. And this is important, for example, if there is a transit signal, if there is a planetary signal, you need to have, for example, the stellar radius to determine how big that planet is. So we'll come back to that, but just to say, this is a great place to find out all of that information. Mm-hmm. And The other thing is we have the magnitude. So magnitude is kind of a proxy for how bright this target is. And we have it in lots of different bands. So I like to use V band. This is the visual magnitude. This is how we kind of see it. But a very important thing to remember with magnitudes is that the scale is opposite to what you'd expect it to be. So a larger number means it's fainter, and a smaller number means it's brighter, which is very counterintuitive, but just something to keep in mind.
So something that's closer to zero is going to be brighter than something that's like here we see 11. So that, oh no, sorry, I'm looking at the V, that's like a 10. So that's probably faint or fairly faint, or would you consider that still bright?
So the smaller the number is, the easier it is to follow up. So yes, I mean, this is faint, but it's observable.
Right. It's observable to the telescope, maybe not to the human eye. Gotcha.
Obviously. It's a good distinction.
Right. Cool.
And the very last thing that I just want to point out on here very, very quickly is that ExoFOP just summarizes everything that's known about a candidate. So we also have information on here if it's already been observed. So here is just a list of kind of telescopes that have already looked at this candidate, and we see some information about what they found and what they saw. So it's always useful to see what has already been observed, whether it's already been observed, and what people have found. So this is to help us not kind of reobserve things that have already been observed and to waste telescope time that way. So yeah, all in all, a very useful tool. I would recommend you to have a look at ExoFOP, see what other information is on there. And I think in future episodes, we will cover some of the additional information on here that we haven't covered so far.
Agreed. Yeah, that's really cool. And it's nice. It's laid out in a very cohesive and linear way. So you can just get in and have a play and go back and forth between ExoFOP and MAST. And have fun with it. And that's the biggest thing. If you are an early stage citizen scientist, you know, what I have found is like just getting familiar with these sort of areas and not being nervous about, I don't understand what this means, I'm just going to ignore it. Go in, you're not going to break it. That was my biggest thing. I'm going to break it. No, it's going to be fine. So just go in and have fun and become more familiar. If you have any other questions about this, if there's anything else that you want us to explore a little bit further, you know, give us a comment or send us an email, let us know, and we'll look into it. But otherwise, this is going to conclude our sort of little short segment of resources. We'll probably revisit it a little bit later. But in our future episodes, we're going to start to go into coding. So that should be a lot of fun. Have a look for that. Okay. Thank you, Nora. And thank you for joining us. And we'll see you next time. Okay, bye.
Bye.